You just met Dane, right?
Yes.
I think it's just a testament also to how talented he is and how close his emotions are to the surface, because literally all he goes is, I need 5 seconds there.
Yeah.
His instrument doing is that tuned. Is that finely tuned?
That's what he calls it.
I'm set and ready when you guys are.
Where did this begin? Where did this particular... It's a fairly obscure piece of Allen Ginsberg history by most standards, and now it's a really good movie.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. Okay, so the origin story is... Let's see. I can remember being a college freshman and going to the campus bookstore and scanning the poetry aisles and finding the Ginsberg poetry because it just felt like it was this like lifeline, you know, like a secret or some transmission from the future version of myself. Hmm. I was a closeted, young, gay, creative writer from New Jersey, so Allen Ginsberg's poetry meant the world to me at that time. And then when you start to read a little bit, you read a lot with the beats. You know, it's kind of hard to just take a scoop. And this anecdote the film describes this murder, and it's an anecdote in a bunch of the biographies. So it's actually not that obscure if you know the beat history, but the funny thing is most of the anecdotes are just that, they're just anecdotes. And the murder was front page New York Times story.
Well, I guess the thing is Lucian did not become as famous as the rest of them, so it seems like it came from somewhere else.
Yeah, but if you read the Times stories, you know, it's pretty, the murder is pretty outrageous. I mean, it's kind of amazing to think nobody had tackled this before. That was the thing we kept circling around, was the mystery of...
Yeah, it's like, you think you know the beats, well, you've never heard this before.
Yeah.
You know, beat aficionados know the story, but where this really came from is the two of us we're college roommates, and we've been best friends since we were 19.
Yeah.
And about 10 years ago, Austin came with me. At that time, he was a short story writer of some renown and a playwright, and came to me with the idea of doing this story about, you know, the secret murder behind these authors that we love so much as a play. Mm. And of course, I just gotten out of film school at the time. I started seeing the movie version go off in the back of my head, and I gave him the Jedi mind trick and was like, I think that play would be really flat and dull, and I don't know what the theme is, but as a movie.
Yeah.
But what was really great is we got to collaborate together.
Yeah.
And, you know, how often do you, with your college friends, you know, like, we've been showing each other's work for years and giving each other notes, but this gave us the chance to work together and do something.
Of course, this is often how relationships are destroyed. Wait. By working together.
You know, working together is really like a relationship.
Yeah.
And some collaborations work and some don't. And I think one of the reasons this one works so well for both of us is it's all about honesty. And just being able to be emotionally vulnerable and to be able to talk about conflict with each other if and when it arises. Mm. But also, like, we know each other's sense of humor so well.
Yeah.
We know we share all those movies that we watched in college together and loved, and then we could use as touch pieces for this film. Mm. And, you know, one thing I think is really good is that I'm more, I think, from film school of a structuralist. I am that kind of writer who does note cards for each scene, and I'm really about creating the spine first. Mm. And Austin, coming from more of a playwriting background and a short story background, is on this like religious crusade against expositionary dialogue. And so he is great with character and dialogue, and I'm kind of the structure guy. So in a way, you know,
complimentary.
Daryl Hall, John Oates, like, it's a partnership that
I had his album.
It's generous to be the Oates.
He looks more like Daryl Hall.
Yes, it's true.
Yeah.
But, I mean,
Daryl was the
When you position yourself as the Oates as opposed to the Hall, it's a very
overshadowed quickly.
Kind thing to do.
Millie and Vanilli.
That one we're not as clear about. It'd be like, you don't want to be, what's the other guy from George Michael? See, I don't even know his name anymore. Andrew Ridgely. You don't want to be the Andrew Ridgely of the pairing.
Good memory.
Though.
John's.
No, but what's good is too is, you know, because I directed the movie, but Austin was on set almost every day, and they're functioning then as the sole writer of the film. Because when we would run into production mishaps, I mean, we shot this movie in 24 days. Each scene that you've seen in this movie is, you know, I would say approximately we did it in 2 hours or less. So there were obviously times, it was like student filmmaking again, when obstacles would present themselves in the path, oh, we just lost the location, we need a rewrite. And Austin was on set and could be the authoritative writer behind the piece. So it was great just to have, you know, that collaboration persisted. And even in the editing process, he was present a lot.
Which was
in
awesome.
In the editing room, which was great.
I don't think that's that common for screenwriters to be that close to it.
No.
So I felt really lucky.
Definitely not.
Yeah.
They're usually banned. They may show up in a set for a day or two, and then the director quietly tells them not to let them on the set anymore. Yeah, usually.
I've often wondered, and maybe it's a naive question, why that is, because I feel like the screenwriter would have something to say that might be useful, and if they have the right attitude, I mean, trying to edit a film without the screenwriter sometimes. I mean, I remember the first day of shooting, we shot the crescendo film, the crescendo scene of the film, the jail cell. Yeah. And you're watching, and these poor actors, it's day one, they're an hour into their roles, and they're watching their friendship like implode. And so I can remember there were so many things we're worrying about. The light, the sound, is the buzzer on the jail door, is it going to work at the right time? And to be a screenwriter on set watching that happen and think, wait a second, Alan's walking up this hallway of the Queen's House of Detention. He doesn't really know where he's going, right? I mean, this is the first time he's been there. He needs to look in the cells and make sure that he's looking for his friend. It's not like he can assume where he's going. And that's just one of those things as a screenwriter I felt like I was noticing, but with all the production demands, nobody had time for it. So, like, for me, in the history of my experience with this film, I felt really privileged to be there because that was something I could whisper to you, like, John, hey, we should mention something. This is like, you know, it's hard for these actors to track that kind of thing. They're not even...
I think, yeah, the secret is every director has a director whisperer. And to be able to have the collaborator on the film with me who wrote it with me and been my friend for so long.
Yeah.
It was just, you know, we need someone, it's just to make sure that we're not forgetting anything and to have our backs.
Well, whispering, I think the reason that people don't do it is because not every writer is a whisperer. the director will find the writer in the trailer with an actor directing him, basically, and that director freaks out. And that's, you know, you got to have a lot of cooks and not too many chefs. So
you laid down the law pretty early, because in theater there is a little bit more porousness between, say, playwright and actor. And you early on were like, we were in rehearsals, the 2 days of rehearsals that we actually had. And you said, listen, the actors need to pay attention to me, and, you know, this isn't really the time to give them the Allen Ginsberg journals. You know, for example, I was like, why don't you read this, like, obscure chapter from the Allen Ginsberg journals to get a sense of the scene? I didn't know any better. Anyway, so.
So as you developed the script, did you find a home for it in that process, or did you wait till you finished and you had a script and went around to try to sell it, or?
You know, basically what happened is this was like, you know, the band Postal Service? Mm-hmm. And they ended up, you know, sending the demo tracks back and forth through the mail, and that's why they called it that. We were living in two different cities for most of the time, you know, and it took, I would say, 4 years to write, but it was like the passion thing we did on the side. You know, we were both struggling, we were teaching, we were doing various other jobs to pay the rent. And then once we kind of felt like we were done, Austin had co-wrote Christine Vachon's second book. And so we sent it to Christine, thinking that would probably just end up in some huge pile on her desk.
Which it did.
But then in one of the more just kind of poignant moments, and like really the beginnings of my career, all of a sudden I found myself here in Los Angeles, and Christine Vachon was flying out here to meet with me to convince me to produce the movie.
So she just finally found it on the desk?
I think what she would tell you is that probably because I had worked with her, you know, I did book ghostwriting for a couple of years to make some money and support myself. And working with her, we had a friendship. And so when she saw my name on this script, I had never told her about it. She had no idea it was coming. She picked it up, she was intrigued. And to be honest, killer films, those movies from the 90s and early 2000s, I mean, we loved those films. Yeah. This movie is written in their spirit in some ways. And so it was a perfect film for her. And I think she just responded, and she would say she sparked to the material. And so then we had lunch with her, and she was really supportive from the beginning. So, and then
she actually had no notes on the script.
No notes.
Wow.
I know.
And she had one note to me. I started talking about, you know, how this movie takes place in 1944, and it's a story of murder. And when I started doing research and I looked to say what won Best Picture that year, it was Double Indemnity, Billy Wilder's film. It was a year of lore, it was a year of guilt, it was a high point of American film noir. So that's why, even from the screenplay itself, we structured it as a noir film, starting with a heightened point of tension, and then flashing back to more innocent times, and then seeing how we get to this place, and will the characters escape or not escape their fate. So as I'm telling this to Christine, she goes, okay, one note. No black and white.
Yeah, exactly.
Great thing about Christine is, honestly, people ask me a lot about the choices that I made in this film, the contemporary soundtrack, the jazzy editing, and just kind of how alive and youthful it is. A lot of that I want to give credit. Christine kept saying to me, John, this is, you know, you've been fighting so long to get this movie made. You know, me speaking to you now is over 10 years from the first conversation Austin and I had about this film. This is yours, John, and this might never happen again. Make bold choices. Don't just rely on simple coverage unless that's what you want. But if you want to do something, if you have an idea, don't be scared. Trust your gut. Go for it. And just having that kind of creative producer behind you just really let me feel free to go and then leap off of all the academic research we had done that I had done for the film and just to trust my gut and the people that I was working with and the cast that you know, you've met. And the film all of a sudden started taking a life of its own during production and becoming so much more younger and rebellious. and free than kind of this noir-esque film that I had initially anticipated.
Hmm. Well, do you think that was the cast, or was that the...
It was a couple of things. It was, you know, my original intentions was to look at film noirs, but as I did so, I thought, this is kind of boring. Who wants to do an academic recreation of a film noir in present day? Mm-hmm. And as I kept on doing research, I was looking to see where noir went in terms of color. I realized, oh yeah, the French got their hands on it and turned it into something called the New Wave. Mm-hmm. And I thought, going back to the structuralist side, well, that's a great arc for the film and for the character. Mm-hmm. To go from a place of conformity and a lockdown camera, you know, the row houses of New Jersey, the halls of Columbia University, to as these guys start going on the rabbit hole together, taking the camera off the tripod and having a much more fun, freestyle, handheld camera, and going from this place of film noir to new wave over the course of the film. But then you hire great people. You hired Reed Morano as your, you know, DP, Stephen Carter as your production designer, Chris Peterson as your costume designer, and they started bringing great ideas now that they had my framework of what I wanted. Mm. And we started realizing, let's find, this is a movie about young people. This isn't a traditional biopic. This is about, you know, 19-year-olds finding their voice. Let's do this in the style of a 19-year-old's perspective and make it feel fresh and contemporary. So we looked at Ryan McGinley photographs. We looked at contemporary photography and styles that were still somewhat used or resonant in the 1940s as well. Mm-hmm. Jack Kerouac's flannel shirts, for example, being a prime example. You know what I mean? Like, what were those connections between the past and the present? Then I brought the cast on board. And you know, what an amazing cast. And they're just energy and excitement. Yeah. I actually fought for rehearsal days before the movie, and I stole the method from Francis Ford Coppola, where you do improvs, but not of the scenes that exist in the script, of scenes that don't exist in the script. Mm-hmm. So that way nobody gets tied down to a reading, and everyone just starts playing around and owning their own character and forging relationships with each other. We ended up stealing a lot of those improvs and putting them into the movie. Mm-hmm. And then add to that, what?
France is a good place to steal from. Francis Ford.
Actually, no, I'm just thinking, what is it? The bad artists steal, good artists borrow? I borrowed from Francis Ford Coppola. And then add to that, though, the truth, the shooting schedule was so insanely fast that handheld jazzy, I'm glad that that was, like, you know, our intuition of where to go with this film, because we had to even own that even more.
Right.
And there were plenty of times where the scenes that we shot, literally, I didn't cut the camera, because if I cut it, we'd have to move on to the next scene. Because I learned as a director a trick. As soon as you say action, everyone on set has to be quiet. So what we would literally do is reset within takes, and we would do the wide shot, and then I'd wink over to Reed, and she wouldn't cut, and I would say reset, and Daniel Radcliffe and Dane DeHaan would do each other's hair and put the props back, and then we'd move in for a tighter shot. But Reed had shot plenty of documentaries as well. She did the LCD sound system documentary, Shut Up and Play the Hits. So she just had that intuition of knowing where to follow, you know, the prop that was the central thing that moves the story forward, to follow the prop, for example. So all of these things combined, I think, is what really kind of added and created this kind of really youthful, rebellious spirit to the film.
So when did the avalanche of talent start falling upon you? Acting talent. Not your life talent, but...
You know, what was really exciting was, you know, as soon as Christine came on board with the script, we actually started getting reaction from really talented and great actors. And Daniel Radcliffe was an idea that I had come up with. I was making a list of kind of young actors under 25 who I not only admired, but I thought are bright enough and are sensitive enough that we'd believe them as a young Allen Ginsberg. Mm-hmm. And when I wrote down his name, I thought to myself, well, the arc of his character in this movie is someone who starts off a dutiful son, who's kind of only shown the world one color and one side of themselves, but knows that they have so much more to offer. And by the end of the film, of course, he's a rebel, he's a poet, and he's shown the world that he is his own man. And I did not know Daniel Radcliffe at this time, but I thought to myself, maybe he can relate to this. Mm-hmm. I sent it to his agent liked it, gave it to Dan. Next thing I knew, I was flying to see Dan while he was doing Equus. And you have these things called actor dates, and they're really like dates, because you know within 5 minutes whether or not there's chemistry there. And I knew as a first-time director that there would have to be an insane amount of trust between me and my lead actor, because they were putting their faith in me to get a great performance when all I had done was two short films, and that I needed to trust them that they were going to bring the character that we had been working on so hard to life. Mm-hmm. We spent like 5 hours gossiping with each other, sharing intimate secrets. You know, like that trust was there. It was a really good first date.
So where, and then he offered. Where did you guys have your first date?
It was in New York, and it was coffee at, I want to say, the Soho House. Ah. But then...
A five-hour coffee is good.
Five-hour coffee is really good, right?
That's usually a good sign. Usually marriage will come out of that, or at least long-term relationship.
John is the...
It was a long-term relationship. He's been with me 4.5 years trying to get this movie made. No, but then he offered to audition for me, which was just a testament to his character. He wanted to make sure that he had all the abilities and the emotional qualities that I wanted for the role. And in some, this is much more independent film and less sexy than the Soho House. In like a corporate, you know, Midtown boardroom, we took over and the two of us did a couple of the scenes together and did some improvs. And it was watching the character that we had written. You know, I don't necessarily usually write for actors, but I have a vague idea of what that person is or who it's going to be. And I was watching it come to life in front of me. You know, because there's this other role he did for 10 years. I can't remember the name of the character.
Right.
But, you know, he was playing one role, so you only show what? You know, a couple of colors in each role.
Yeah.
And he was showing me all of these different emotional colors that I hadn't seen in his work before, but he had deep emotional connections too. And they were the qualities that we needed for Allen Ginsberg.
We were all waiting to see him bald, so it'll be at the end.
Well, here's we did extensive research. You know, we started off, obviously there's tons of biographies. There was the newspaper articles written about the murder. I went to the Stanford University Allen Ginsberg Archives, which had a huge photo collection.
Yeah.
And Dan doesn't look that dissimilar from a young Allen Ginsberg. He was a looker.
Yeah.
And...
Well, nerd is in, so like that helped, you know? We didn't have to work too hard.
Well, you probably couldn't have made the movie without David Cross. So it'd been...
David Cross was actually, no, I needed to cement my lead before I cast around him.
Right.
You know, what I was really trying to emulate was the Social Network casting. I just thought David Fincher did such a great job of finding the next generation of fantastic up-and-coming actors and assembling them all together. So it really was going and making a list of, you know, all the young actors who I admired. You know, Dane DeHaan, actually, that was my boyfriend's idea. He watched In Treatment, and he was a huge fan. And he said, you're going to cast Dane DeHaan. But of course, you know how we are with our loved ones. I had to go find and go on my own journey to discover that he was right, like he always is. And we did old-fashioned Hollywood chemistry reads. And Dane was the first one in, and he blew us away.
Yeah, he was totally.
And he made
it
really difficult for all the actors that came in after him. Michael C. Hall, you know, was Austin actually? You had always written.
We'd written that part. I'd written that part with him in mind, just because I'd loved him from 6 Feet Under. And what we know about David Cameron is that he's, you know, was the, one of the brightest people in the room. He was a little bit of the kind of older brother to these guys, and that he had red hair and this really remarkable red beard. People used to refer to him as Swinburne. So, I mean, there are not that many actors that match that type. And at the time, 6 Feet Under was, I mean, a show I was obsessed with. And we
That's how long you've been working on this movie. That's,
I know.
He's
I know.
Had a whole other series.
I know, exactly. And, yeah, we were, it just seemed to me like dream casting to get Michael C. Hall.
There wasn't a moment where you thought about doing it yourself? That wasn't the...
I'm not really an actor. John and I did, you know, start in college as actors, but we learned quickly that we're really bad.
We were in a freshman year production of The Lion in Winter together.
Terrible.
He was the noble son, I was the evil
Richard the Lionhearted, yeah, you were the... Lots of leggings. Leggings, flats, poofy skirts, whatever they used to call those things that men used to wear. Anyway, there are photos on the internet, I'm sure, somewhere. Don't click on that. Don't click.
Do not click. So, okay, so what else? But I mean, David Cross kind of does give you the future glimpse of what we expect Allen Ginsberg to look like. That's the.
That was, of course, the fact that he had played Allen Ginsberg and I'm Not There was one of the things that keyed me into, this is kind of an interesting metacasting choice. But what I really loved about it is, obviously.
Another Christine movie, by the way.
Yeah.
A great Christine movie. What I loved about it, though, is everyone who was doing this movie was really doing something new. You know, the whole spirit of the film was showing, you know, is being 18, 19 and showing the world that you just have so much more to offer and that you want to shake up the system and do something authentic and unique that nobody expects from you. And a lot of the cast that came to us, like David Cross, had never done a straight dramatic role before, but he was game. And I think he did a fantastic job.
What about Ben? Was Ben kind of like the adult on the set, or was he
interesting?
Ben was in his own space.
No, Ben, here's the thing about Ben. Ben, is, like, all the young actors looked up to him.
Yeah.
Which was the role of William Burroughs to these other guys. And it was so poignant to see Dan and Dane kind of circling around Ben. And, you know, Ben has certain methods of acting that I watched Daniel Radcliffe then borrow and use over the course of the film. So in a way, he was a mentor to these guys real life as well.
Let's say, too, that Ben came to this script obsessed already with Bill Burroughs. I mean, he'd done a ton of research. He knew his life story backwards and forwards. He knew something about his literary style. So he brought a ton to us to enhance that role, to make us think about, oh, right, how can we pay this off? And what's going on psychologically for him in this dynamic? So that was a huge gift. I mean, as a screenwriter, having an actor like that come in so preloaded with so much material and passion for the part, I was total luck, and I feel very honored that he was in it.
And Ben has so much heart, and he would come up to me during the day if he saw, you know, me particularly a little frazzled or stressed out, and he would say, John, make it new, make it your own.
Aww.
You know, and he's very touching, and he's got the biggest heart in the world.
Mm. And then he had the waffle truck come at midnight to get everybody a free waffle with ice cream.
He did, on a particularly hard night, he had the mud coffee and waffle truck come. Mm. To treat the cast.
Which is a thing.
Crew.
I don't know. Do you even know what that is?
I do.
Yeah, okay.
I have a little life in New York before that.
Oh, yeah, so you know.
Elizabeth Olsen, that was lucky in that I had just seen Marlene.
You did it.
and was blown away like the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. And it just happened that she wanted to do a period piece next.
And did she work 2 days? Did she work at, I mean, it was a very small role for her.
Yeah. It was and it wasn't, in that it was always going to be the boys' movie, but, you know, I've been asked the question, what darling did you have to kill? And there are several, she had a much larger part in the film, and her relationship with Jack was pretty complex and mirrored and worked against Alan's relationship with Lucian. And we just had the situation where after seeing the first cut, we saw that we had a movie and a half on our hands. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, it's the tertiary characters that are usually the first ones to go when you need to cut scenes from the movie. Her work is so good in the movie and in those scenes. So I'm fighting right now to get those scenes onto the DVD, at least in the director's cut, or at least the deleted scenes category, and let history kind of decide whether or not I made the right decision. But I want the world to see them.
So when you say you made the right decision, is that a decision of, this is what the running time should be for a movie like this,
to be honest, it's less about running time. It was more that, you know, the second half of the film is kind of like the darker B-side to the fun of the A-side. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the short, you know, this movie follows the course of a year, and it's kind of like seasons. There's almost four parts to it. And what starts off joyful at the beginning of going to college, you know, becomes darker and darker as the film progresses.
The Help album and Let It Be.
I'll take that. Yeah. I will take that. And, you know, what was happening in the second half of the film is the murder story. You know, that's when it becomes more prevalent.
Which is complicated enough.
And, you know, that became really the primary dramatic moving force for the second half of the film. And Alan's relationship to Lucian and Alan's discovery, attempts to discover what really happened that night, you know, is what's moving the story forward. And so every time we cut away to scenes involving characters not following that A plot, we noticed that, you know, our friends who are our test audiences were getting really upset and thinking that it was distracting away from them emotionally from the primary story.
So you guys did this for 10 years, have been doing this for 10 years plus.
Yeah.
Very passionate about it, very interested, you know, connected to everything, not just another script.
Thank you.
On the other hand, you seem to be completely open in a way that many directors and teams of directors and writers are not necessarily. It's kind of like, sounds like you allowed yourself to breathe in everybody else's stuff, or wanted to. Do you think that's a circumstance of who you are? Is it a matter of it taking so long that you were exhausted by that point, and that's kind of, you needed more support to get through it?
I think. What do you mean, everyone else's stuff?
The actors. It sounds like you were much more inclusive,
taking their input and trying to.
And even having your relationship with your writer, your relationship with your actors, relationship with.
I mean, I'm. While I can be a modest person, obviously I worked incredibly hard and had a very distinct vision for this film. But at the same time, I'd be a fool, this is my first film and I have all the experienced people around me, not to, you know, make use of their own imaginations and suggestions. The important thing is knowing the film that you're making and knowing the parameters, because everyone's going to give you a million ideas of what you could do or how the movie could be.
Right.
And it's your job to listen and to know, this is the movie that I want, that's a great idea that fits in the equation that I've set out for this film. Mm-hmm. You know, I listened to the Criterion Collection commentary for Ang Lee's The Ice Storm. And in it, Fred Elms and people who worked with Ang talk about him making a 50-page Bible of the 1970s. Mm-hmm. Everything from color palettes to fonts to historical events and television shows, basically what the 70s meant to him. I did that with the 1940s. And once I had my book, once I had my spine, then I could go and share this with everybody, with the actors, within my department heads, and say, this is the film that I really want to make. Mm-hmm. And then they bring, with a great, when you hire great people, they bring their own stuff to the table. So maybe this is just who we are as people, but I don't know, we're just, really we're just super excited that we're here in Los Angeles. And it's happened. Yes! Yes!
Let me say too really quickly that, like, I mean, we're making a movie about the Beats. I mean, Kerouac and Ginsberg and Burroughs, these were inclusive people. So, like, to make a movie that, like, violated that spirit would have been a huge mistake. So I just felt like we were just sort of kind of a following, in a way, their spirit. And it's also, John is a really open person. He's the child of a therapist. And so you can see he's emotionally connected. He's not threatened by other people's ideas. I think a lot of writer and director teams can feel threatened by everybody else's expertise. And you really taught me that actually all that input that we got only improved the film.
So we don't want to see the movie you guys make about Nazis, because it'd be a very unpleasant set, sounds like.
Well, that's not, we can't.
No, you just said the themes of the movie, you don't want to make the Beat people, you want to work in the spirit of the Beats. You don't want to work in the spirit of the Nazis.
Well, it wasn't just the spirit of the Beats, to be honest. Let's face it, we were college roommates. This is a movie about college. And it was about incorporating our own personal experiences. I think, like, what I think everyone can relate to has seen this film and come to me, no matter how old they are, whether they're 19 and Daniel Radcliffe fans, or whether they're of a certain age where they grew up with the Beats. We all were that age, 18, 19. We all wanted to be different from our parents. We all wanted to say something unique and start the revolution and do something just important with our lives. You know, and that was us in college together. So to get to make a movie about these guys who also felt the same way in 1944 and then went on to create the greatest counterculture, you know, movement in American history that has persisted, that people are still talking about, that people are still writing about, making movies about, singing about, etc. You know, this was a labor of love for, I think, both of us.
Yeah.
And that enthusiasm just translated, I think, through the cast and through the people we worked with. And it was just one of those, for me, it was one of those experiences where at the end it was so intense, but in a joyful way, and we all felt like we should go get tribal tattoos together.
So show us the tattoos.
Oh, I never got mine. John, did you get yours?
I can't show it on television.
Okay, right. Google it. Click on that.